So in the previous video, we have seen about how the differential works, the general things about differential, and just introduce how the modeling of the differential will be done. So now in this video, we'll look at the details about the modeling, the assembly, and the motion study of the differential. So let's start with it. So Ishan, can you start with how you started sketching the parts and what all different types of gears you have mentioned and how do you model the gears?
Right. So I first define the parameters that I use to make a gear. So we have the module, which basically decides the size of the teeth. Then we have the pressure angle that decides the type of teeth, where the angle at which the force is being acted upon. Then the number of teeth for the type, different both of the type of gears. And finally, the height or the depth of the gear. These were the global parameters I defined. And then to make each of the gears, I started sketching with using these parameters.
Okay. So I think you have assigned those parameters. Those are the variables. So you wanted to parameterize your sketch. That's why you have done this. So you can directly change the values of those parameters from the global variable itself. And changing those values will directly change or automatically change your sketch. And the assembly will also automatically change. So you need not change your sketch manually all the time and your assembly all the time. So you have done a very great job of doing parameterization of all the parts, all the sketch angles. And just for the viewers, the pressure angle and all other different types of things related to tooth or gears are like, we have a module number, a pressure angle, a line of action. There are all many different things which are related to how the tooth and how the gears are to be designed. So we will not go into such details, but one of the parameter such as pressure angle has been used over here. So now Ishan will continue with how he has taken a gear. So he can show you how the gears can be directly used. So over here, Ishan has self-designed all the tooth. So he has designed a single tooth by on his sketching using the knowledge of pressure angle and line of action. But there is another option in the SolidWorks library. So he'll show about that library also, in which you can skip all those steps and you can directly go to that library, standard library, in which there are gears and all different types of gears are directly available, in which you can put down all the values of module, the pressure angle, number of teeth, the diameter of gear, the type of gear, and you are directly done. You did not do any sketching or any modeling of the gears. So he'll show about that library. Go on, Nishan.
So in SolidWorks, if we go to the right-hand side, we have this toolbox, and in that we have different type of standards that are used. So under each standard, you have different type of components pre-made, and under power transmission, and then finally gears, we have the different types of bevel gears and straight gears, other helical gears and all available that can be directly used. And when we import these into the assembly, then we can assign all the parameters that I used earlier, the module, pressure angle, and the number of teeth, etc., to automatically create that gear.
Okay, great. So can you just hide all other parts and show one of the gear and just show what was your general process of making one gear or one tooth of that gear, so it's easier for all others to understand.
Right. So this is the pinion gear that I used. This was the model. And to start, I first sketched the cross section. First, I actually sketched the, we have these bevel gears. So we have gears that are at an angle. They do not extrude vertically upwards. So to account for that, I first made a triangle which had two perpendicular sides. And this was the pinion gear that we'll be making. This is the radius of that. And this is the radius of the side gear that we'll be making later on. So for you, we did this to get this angle which would be formed between those two gears. So after making the sketch, we made the cross section of the gear. This had all the parameters that we assigned earlier. So in this component, we are using the same parameters that were defined locally by referring to the global parameters in the differential assembly. So the module in this particular component is using the value of the module that was in the differential assembly global value. And these are the values of those parameters. So then we made a circle. And then we made three circles, and each of those has a different value. The middle circle is has a formula which is module times the, this is the inner circle. This circle has the diameter equals to the module times the number of teeth. The inner circle has the diameter module times the teeth minus 2.25. And the outer one has the diameter teeth module multiplied by teeth plus 2. So we have these three circles, and then we make an arc between these, from starting from the inner circle going to the outer circle, and intersect it in the middle circle. Then we define the tangential relation of this line and define the 30 degree pressure angle that we use the variable. And then we also define we define the number of teeth. After making the arc, we define the number of teeth using this circular pattern, which is taking the value 10, which is equal to the number of teeth parameter that we use in the global variable. So after forming this sketch, we make a plane that is at a certain height, which is equal to the depth that we defined earlier. And then we scale down the sketch that we just made by a certain amount, which is again defined by this triangle that we made earlier. So we earlier, our sketch has the radius this much, and the new plane that we created is somewhere here. So it should have a scale that should make the diameter shorter. So we scale the sketch. And then finally, we loft between the lower and the upper sketch to form this gear. Then to avoid interaction of the corners, we create a circular cut extrude that clears out these edges from that loft that we created. And finally, we create a hole in the middle that would allow the gear to be mounted on a shaft. And hence, we create this gear, that is the pinion gear.
Okay, so I think you have explicitly used the parameterization so much, and your method is very much robust in designing and sketching of parts. So this is very much useful to everyone also. And similarly, I think all other gears are to be designed, and wherever pinion gears are to be used, we can just repeatedly use the same pinion gear, need not design again and again, right?
Correct.
Okay, so can you directly show the side gears now?
Right. So
this is the side gear. So he'll tell about the side gear modeling also.
So for the side gear, the modeling method was more or less the same. We started with the base cross-section sketch that was modeled in a similar way, the inner diameter, the outer diameter, and the pitch diameter. Then these again are derived by the formula. All of them are parameterized using the same formula that we used earlier. And then we again made the arc with the same pressure angle. So the important parameter is that the gears that are being used together should have the same pressure angle and the same module. And these two are the same global variables we defined earlier. So that is satisfied. Then we again created the plane that is at a height, which is again defined using that earlier rectangle that we made in the earlier gear also. And then we again created a scaled down version of the outer base sketch. And then we finally lofted between those two in a similar manner to create this. And then again, we made a revolve cut to clear out the edges. And finally, the extra thing here was the this backside that was created to allow for the shaft to be mounted to it. And this again has a a smaller gear on the inside that allows for a proper interaction between the shaft and the gear. And this was again modeled in a similar way with a smaller module, because the gear, the size of these teeth are smaller. So this module is much smaller and the number of teeth are much higher. So this again was created through a sketch and finally extruded, cut out of the middle circle. This is how we made the side gear, and this is part of the assembly.
Okay, I think this is it. We have modeled the side gear and the pinion gear. Now you can directly show the inside part that was coming from the engine. That was the driving part for those gears. So that was that green part which we have seen earlier. Yes. So now that the green part is some type of universal joint, which we can say, and that is going to drive all the gears. And the gears which we have used, those are the functions of module number, the number of teeth, and the pressure angle. So Ishan has said earlier also that those the mating gears, the gears which are going to mate with each other, that are going to work with each other, must have the same three values for module, pressure angle, and the number of teeth can change. The module and the pressure angle must remain same. So now this was the driving part, and that's all. So you can directly show the there is nothing about modeling of this. This is very simple. So we can skip the details about it. You can directly show the assembly. This is the complete assembly, which is the inner, this is the complete assembly, including the housing of my differential, and the left and the right part, which are coming out, that the extruded ones, the cylindrical hollow parts, those are where the shaft are going to be attached. So there will be a constant velocity joint, CV joint, which is said, and that CV joint is between the shaft and my gears. And now that the shaft is coming out, and the shaft other end will go to the tire directly. So this is the complete assembly. It can be a cylindrical type of assembly. The housing can be cylindrical. It can be spherical. So you would have generally seen a spherical box type of thing behind or at the rear part of the truck. So that's the differential, which is easily visible because the ground clearance of trucks are high. So that's all we have for this video.